Good morning. Today we will speak about Parkinson's disease. It is also called as paralysis agitans or shaking palsy. Coming to the etiology of the disease, the cause of disease is unknown and genetic factor has been suspected, but definitive evidence are lacking. No evidence exists for viral etiology or hereditofamily association. The clustering of early onset Parkinson's disease in some families have been observed. Clinical feature. Let us go to the clinical features of disease. The onset is gradual. Usually it affects the age between 50 to 60 years. Males are slightly more affected. The classical trait is the first one is a tremor. Second is akinesia or poverty of the movement. Third is the rigidity. So coming to the tremor, this is usually the first sign and commonly noticed in one hand. To start with, it is fine, but gradually becomes coarse as the disease advances. It is regular and static. Rate is 2 to 6 cycles per second. This is mostly manifested in the distal parts of the limbs. Tremor remains localized in one hand for a long time, and after months or years, this spreads to the opposite hand and gradually in the lower limbs. Tremor is also noticed in the tongue, eyelids, lips, around the mouth and lower jaw. In a full-blown case, when the tremor is generalized, it seems as if the patient is in a state of rage, anger or agitation, for which the disease is called paralysis agitans. This can be checked voluntarily or by altering the position of the limb or by some drug. This is exaggerated during emotion, excitement or fatigue and disappears during sleep. This is inversely related with rigidity. This tremor simulates pill rolling, cigarette peeking or drum beating finger movements. So these are about the tremors. Coming to the second important feature, is the poverty of movement, which is called akinesia or bradykinesia. This follows tremor. Automatic movements are first affected. Thus, when the patient walks, the swinging of the arm is lost. If the patient slips, he does not always make necessary movements to preserve his balance. However, it is interesting to note that during emergency, sometimes effective voluntary activity may be regained very briefly. Standing, sitting, in fact, every activity, all will be slow. Longer time is required to take food. Speech is slow and monotonous with the slurring of the consonants and repetition of syllables. This is called monotonous speech. The gait is composed of short, shuffling steps, which is called festinant or shuffling gait. If the patient is pushed from back, the forward movements become rapid and it seems as if the patient is trying to catch his center of gravity. This is called propulsion. Similarly, retropulsion and lateral pulsions are also seen. Sometimes patient may fall stiffy like a log of wood or telegraph pole. Face loses its expression. There is a staring look. due to loss of blinking, and this is called masked facies or Parkinsonian face. However, on tapping twice over the glabella, continuous blinking is seen. This is called glabellar tap sign or Myhre-Sums sign. Now, coming to the rigidity, this follows a tremor. This is of a cogwheel type because associated tremor. Cogwheel rigidity is mostly seen in upper limbs, while the lead pipe rigidity develops mainly in the lower limbs. Whole body becomes rigid. There is a rigidity of the neck, trunk, upper and lower limbs, as a result of which there may be flexed neck and trunk, flexed and crossed upper limbs and flexed lower limbs. Thus, the patient assumes a stooping forward posture during standing. Rarely, a hyper-extended position may be seen. There is difficulty in turning from side to side or change of posture in the bed or to stand up from sitting posture. Buttoning and combing are practically impossible. Due to presence of rigidity, in the early stage, jerks are brisk, but gradually they cannot be elicited due to rigidity. Cramp or muscle pain is quite common due to rigidity. Handwriting becomes cramped and tends to become progressively smaller. Next. No sensory or sphincter change and superficial reflex remain normal. Next is the involvement of autonomic nervous system may give rise to seborrhea of the face and scalp, and there will be a salivary drooling, a central Horner syndrome, dysphagia, orthostatic hypotension, etc. Non-motor neuropsychiatric features like delusion, hallucination, dementia, impulse disorders predate the motor features. Different types of sleep disorders like insomnia, sleep fragmentation, vivid dreams may also develop. In advanced cases, there may be intellectual deterioration. So, this is about the clinical feature of the Parkinson's disease. Now, coming to the stages of the Parkinson's disease. The stages are, first stage, mild unilateral disease. Second stage, bilateral disease with the early postural changes. Third stage, prominent change in the gait and a moderate generalized disability. Fourth stage, pronounced disability. Fifth stage, the disease steadily progressive but sometimes may remain stationary. Coming to the differential diagnosis, we can think of one, post-encephalitic Parkinsonism, then hepatolenticular degeneration, third, arteriosclerotic pseudo-Parkinsonism, Parkinsonism, then even in anxiety disorders you can come across this, where the hands are cold, sweating is present, tremor is fine, not coarse, and tachycardia, rigidity is usually absent in anxiety. Then thyrotoxicosis, tremor is fine and manifested in outstretched fingers, protruded tongue, thyroid is enlarged with the thrill and systole murmurate. Next, senile tremors, it occurs in aged individuals only and manifested during work. Tremor is fine with the high rate. Disseminated sclerosis, tremor is cerebellar in type and disease starts at a comparatively younger age, recurrence and relapse are very common. So nystagmus ataxia are common. Then benign, essential or familial tremors, it may be inherited or as an autosomal dominant. It starts at any age and increases the emotional upset. Hands are involved but legs are spread. Treatment. In the treatment, we should encourage the physical activity of the patient first, then warmth and passive movements are helpful for rigidity. And drug treatment, in the early stages, drugs are not required. Anticholinergic drugs are more useful for combating tremor and rigidity with the bradykinesia. The anticholinergic drugs, they are having common side effects like dry mouth, blurred vision, confusion, palpitation, retention of urine, constipation, agitation, etc. These drugs should not be used in prostatic enlargement, intestinal obstruction, narrow angle glaucoma, and it should be started with small dose. And then dose may be increased till desired effect is appeared. The common drugs used are trihexyphenidyl, otherwise called trade name Artane, 1 to 6 mg daily. Rigidity, akinesia, and oculogenic crisis are improved by this drug. Second, benzotropine, or in trade name is Cogenitin, 1 to 3 mg twice daily. Its main effect is on tremor and rigidity. Then third is Orfendrin, a trade name is Disipal. It is given in the dose of 150 to 400 daily. Its main effect is on tremor and rigidity. Then fourth drug is Procyclidin. It is given 7.5 to 30 mg daily. Its main effect is on rigidity. Then next drug is Biperidin or Echinatone, 2 to 12 mg daily. Then chlorophenoxamine may also be given in the dose of 150 to 400 mg per day. Then cyclamine, 5 to 20 mg per day may be given. These are the first line of anticholinergic drugs commonly given in the Parkinson's. So second drug is amantadine, AMANTADINE. This is used in mild cases. Dose is 100 mg twice daily. There is overall improvement from all angles. Its mode of action is unclear. Side effects like postural hypotension, urine retention, psychosis, depression may develop. Then most important popular drug is the third one, that is called levodopa, L-E-V-O-D-O-P-A. This is converted to dopamine in the body. It improves all the major features of the Parkinsonism: nausea, vomiting, cardiac arrhythmias, orthostatic hypotension are common side effects. Behavioral changes may be then dyskinesia may develop, chorea, athetosis, tremor, dystonia, myoclonus may result as a part of the parts of the dystonia. A peculiar complication is on and off phenomena in which abrupt but transient fluctuation in the severity Parkinsonism may occur unpredictably, but particularly during the day. During the off period, there is a bradykinesia, and during on period, dyskinesia will be markedly prominent. Sometimes levodopa is given with the carbidopa, which inhibits the enzyme responsible for breakdown of the levodopa to dopamine. intracellular breakdown of levodopa is diminished. However, this combination cannot prevent the development of on and off phenomena. In a fixed ratio, carbidopa and levodopa may also be given by using cinamet in a small dose to start with, gradually increase the dose depending on the improvement. Levodopa should not be given in patient with psychic disorders or narrow angle glaucoma. Next drug is called dopamine agonists. These drugs act on dopamine receptors. These are used particularly when levodopa therapy is refractory or associated with marked off-and-on phenomena. With a low and fixed dose of cinamet, bromocriptine, the important member of this group, is used and gradually the dose of bromocriptine is increased till the desired effect is obtained or side effects develop. To start with the dose of 1.25 mg twice daily and increased by 2.5 mg after every 2 weeks interval. The usual maintained dose is 10 to 30 mg per day. Next drug is selegiline, S-E-L-E-G-A-L-I-N-E. This is a monoaminase oxidase B inhibitor, which is sometimes used as an adjunct to levodopa therapy. This drug prevents the breakdown of dopamine, hence it is useful. The dose is 5 mg with breakwater and 5 mg with lunch. Next comes the COMT, C capital O capital M T, COMT inhibitor like tolcapone, that is 100 to 200 mg 8 hourly, and entacapone 200 mg with each dose of levodopa, also gives beneficial result. Then atypical antipsychotics, drug-induced confusion psychotic may be relieved by using oblanazepine, O-B-L-A-N-Z-A-P-N-E, and risperidone, R-E-S-P-E-R-I-D-O-N-E, and clozapine. Clozapine is more beneficial and can be started at 6.25 mg at bedtime, and dose is increased to 25 to 100 mg per day. Surgical treatment. Destruction of globus pallidus, ventrolateral nucleus of the thalamus by stereotaxic surgical procedure may also be done. Dementia is a contraindication to surgery. So this is about specific treatment. Then coming to general treatment, this includes good nutrition, foods, physiotherapy and speech therapy. Brain stimulation, high frequency electrical stimulation of thalamus, subthalamic nuclei or globus pallidus is also beneficial. Thank you.